By the time he came to see the bridge opened, Brunel was a broken man. He had grown tired and disillusioned by railways. His visionary broad gauge had been killed off by the other railway companies. They were only interested in making profits, not better railways. I endeavour to comprehend the present extraordinary state of railway matters when everyone around seems mad, stark, staring, wildly mad. The only sane course for a sane man is to get out and keep quiet. Brunel didn't keep quiet, though. Far from it. In fact, he was about to make the biggest noise of his entire career. These slabs stretching into the Thames from the Isle of Dogs here were to be the launch pad for the biggest, most impressive, most astonishing engineering feat probably ever, actually. Probably ever. In his mind, he had the idea for another ship. He was thinking about building something called the Great Eastern, which would be able to sail all the way to Australia, non-stop, without refueling. And now there was another weapon in his PR arsenal, photography. This revolutionary new medium recorded each faltering step, each anxious glance, as well as the image that immortalized Brunel. He looks relaxed here, doesn't he? Confident. But the truth is, this ship was tearing him apart. Now, the Great Britain had been a big ship in its time, make no mistake about that. But now he was thinking about making something twice the size. A Leviathan. Technically speaking, it would be something like this. This was the size of a normal ship in the middle of the 19th century. This was the size of Brunel's Great Western. This was the Great Britain. And now he was talking about doing something this big. Nothing this enormous had ever been attempted before, and nothing this enormous would ever be attempted again for 50 years until the Lusitania came along. It was an absolute monster. Alongside the photographers, artists came to paint it, and journalists to write about this huge thing that was towering over the London skyline. Like the Thames Tunnel 30 years earlier, Brunel had scripted another East End soap opera, and Londoners were captivated by each new shocking episode. He went into business with a shipbuilder called John Scott Russell, but it was a stormy partnership. They quarrelled over who was in charge, and work fell behind. The finances spiralled out of control. Huge quantities of materials went missing. Brunel was mortified. Money was so tight that he was reduced to listing the contents of his house, fearing he'd have to sell his silver to save his ship. The company directors became so desperate for cash, they even tried to claw back a few quid by selling tickets for the launch. Thousands came, but the ship was too heavy to budge. Brunel felt publicly humiliated. Finally, they got it afloat and the problems really started. During trials, six men were killed when a funnel exploded, and on her maiden voyage, there were only 38 passengers. There was simply no demand for a ship this big. So the Leviathan became a transatlantic cable layer. And then what? Where is it now? Well, it didn't sink. It didn't hit an iceberg. Its last days were spent as an advertising hoarding on the River Mersey. And then it was simply broken up for scrap. Only one piece of this magnificent ship survives, in the most unlikely place. all that's left of it. The flagpole which today stands outside Liverpool Football Club. What a tragedy. Brunel didn't even live to see the ship sail. 5 minutes after he posed for this last photograph, he collapsed from a stroke. 10 days later, he was dead. His bridge in Bristol was completed 5 years later as a tribute, and rightly so. You see, at around this time, Darwin told the world where we had come from. But Brunel had done something so much more important. He took us to where we were going. You know, I'm slightly amazed that someone like Princess Diana is being discussed in this series. I mean, I'm sure she was a very lovely lady, but she's not really in the same class as Brunel. And John Lennon, I am the Eggman, I am the Walrus. Quite. And then there's William Shakespeare, a man who's brought stupefying boredom to the classroom for 400 years. Let me put it this way. In A Midsummer Night's Dream, Puck says he will put a girdle around the earth. Shakespeare wrote about it, but Brunel, with his bridges and his ships and his trains, he actually did it. Greatest Britain ever? I'm absolutely sure of it. Good night.